Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Drink, a Classical Guide to the Art of Imbibing by Vincent Obsopoeus, translated and edited by Michael Fontaine. Introduction by Michael Fontaine. Read by Roger Clark. Introduction. America has a drinking problem. Shots, chugging, contests, frat culture, bro culture, puking, passing out, driving home. The traditional name for self-destructive drunkenness is methi in Greek, ebrietas in Latin, and alcoholism in English. The latest name is alcohol use disorder, AUD, according to the National Institute on Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism. 16 million people in the United States, more than 6% of us, have it, and more than 90% of them receive no treatment. Temperance failed, prohibition failed, and here we are. But it's not just America. Binge culture is spreading worldwide, with many calling it an American import. But that isn't quite right. People have always gotten drunk and suffered the consequences. In ancient Rome, you were supposed to water your wine, merum, down to a third of its strength and control yourself. Not everyone did. In enjoying the freedom that men do, remarked Seneca, women are now enjoying men's problems too. They stay out late at night, no less. They drink, no less. They challenge men to wrestling and drinking alcohol, merum. And out of equally upset stomachs, they spit and barf all the wine back up. With a few exceptions, though, binge and bro culture were largely alien to ancient Greece and Rome. The idea that hardcore drinking is a mark of he-man prowess first emerged in Germany in the 15th century and spread like a virus in the 16th. I'll say that again. Binge and bro culture, so familiar to Americans, started not in classical Greece or Rome, but in Germany 500 years ago. The Crusades were over, the economy was changing, and the knights of the medieval world no longer had any purpose in their lives. They turned to wine to fill the void. Jousting gave way to drinking contests, and with Germany's vineyards four times larger, and per capita consumption six times higher than today, the pressure to indulge was ample. In the 15th century, Germans were drinking over 120 liters of wine a head a year. The allowance for a patient in hospital, also for a doctor, was 7 liters a day. It is said that teetotalism ruled out any chance of preferment in the priesthood. This is the wine-soaked world Vincent Obsopoeus knew. When he published The Art of Drinking, Obsopoeus, whose name sounds like Job Sopoeus, had been the rector of an elite high school for 8 years in Ansbach, a city just south of Würzburg and Franconia's wine-growing region. Inspired by Ovid's ancient Art of Love, he lifted his pen to compose a how-to manual to teach the art of drinking responsibly, sustainably, and with discrimination. He wanted young men to clean up their act and get married. Like Ovid, he sought to devise a total system for channeling primal energies that are typically regarded as ungovernable. The result is an antidote to chaos and a timeless classic. In America, today, the opposite of sleeping around is not celibacy, but monogamy. In The Art of Drinking, Obsopoeus recommends an analogous attitude toward alcohol. For him, moderation, not abstinence, is the key to lasting sobriety. Listeners familiar only with the Alcoholics Anonymous approach to managing addiction will be surprised. Obsopoeus drafted The Art of Drinking while hanging around the learned monks of Heilsbrunn Abbey in Ansbach, and a former wine steward there, One Sebastian Hamaxergis composed a poetic blurb for it that Obsopoeus splashed across the title page. In it, the celibacy-bound monk remarks on the poem's superficial resemblance to Ovid's Art of Love. Yes, Ovid did do an impressive job of dictating rules for love, so that a definite art would channel that insane madness. Far more impressively, though, Vincent teaches the art of drinking so that a definite limit is constantly in force. And while loving is a no-no, drinking is a pleasure, and giving it rules transforms it into a virtue. Clever enough, since the beginning of The Art of Drinking does contain a half-dozen allusions to Ovid's poem. What Hamaxergis's analogy doesn't spell out, though, is that where Ovid is ironic, Obsopoeus is deadly serious. Most of us think Ovid doesn't really mean what he says, whereas the sincerity of Obsopoeus's moral purpose is beyond doubt. His text pulls back the curtain on the birth of a new and poisonous culture of hazing, peer pressure, competitive drinking, and even in Book 2 on what some now call toxic masculinity. Warning us against the siren song of excessive drinking, therefore, the first two books of The Art of Drinking teach us not how to abstain from drinking, but how to get control of it, how to win friends and impress people at social gatherings, and how to live up to our potential. In the third book, the mask slips, and Obsopoeus tells us how to win competitive drinking games, citing extensive personal experience. Obsopoeus published The Art of Drinking in 1536, and republished an expanded edition the next year. It proved popular, but in time the Catholic Church placed it on its index of forbidden books. As explained, next, the present book is offered as a third edition of the poem. His art propounded a system he found to get hammered with honor. Calixtus Fontanus. Born around 1498 in the village of Heideck, 30 miles south of Nuremberg, Vincent Obsopoeus is not regarded as a major poet, but he should be. The Reformation got underway in his neighborhood in his lifetime, and he played a bit part in it. His humanist surname implies his father was a private chef, Greek Obsopoeus, German Koch, of some local importance. His brother, Michael Obsopoeus, a Bavarian preacher, spent 6 years in a monastery jail on unspecified charges. In 1532, Vincent married Margareta Herzog of Nuremberg, and 6 or 7 years later he added a touching remark about her to a footnote. As far as I'm concerned, there is nothing sweeter, nicer, or more precious than my wife. So help me God, I hope we never change. Even if we live longer than Nestor and the Sibyl of Cumae, I hope I'll always be young for her and she for me. His words are all the more poignant because by the time they saw print, Obsopoeus was dead. He had fallen sick and died a few months earlier, between April and August of 1539. His life had been a troubled one. Vincent Obsopoeus was a strange and difficult character, a man beset by enemies who knew nothing of his existence. He was funny and fun, but sensitive and stubborn, impetuous and intolerant, the kind of person who just can't let something go. The famous humanists he regarded as friends, Philip Melanchthon, Eobanus Hessus, Joachim Camerarius, tolerated rather than liked him. He was quick to smirk at others' failings. He wanted to alienate himself by being obnoxious, thought Camerarius, while Melanchthon declared him a total basket case. The beginning of a letter Camerarius wrote him reveals the dynamics of their relationship. Whoa, Obsopoeus, whoa, enough already. My mind kept saying that over and over as I read your letter, but your letter just went on spewing venom right up to the very end. Another letter Camerarius wrote him is the cover sheet for three poetic blurbs he composed for The Art of Drinking. In it, Camerarius tries to forestall some other impulse. If you're serious about this and won't listen to friendly or even sensible advice, then fine, do as you will. You're the one taking the risk. I won't try to stop you or your impulsivity any longer, but do give some thought, even at this hour, to what an awful war you're tipping off. But, of course, you've thought everything through as you think it's best. Camerarius may well have meant Obsopoeus' plan to publish The Art of Drinking. As Horace once quipped, Laudibus arguitor vini vinosus Homerus. You can tell Homer was a wino. His praise of wine proves it. In the letter, Camerarius warns Obsopoeus that everyone will make the same assumption of him. I'm enclosing the verses you asked for. Feel free to disfigure your book with them, if you insist. And if you do publish it, you won't easily convince everyone of your sobriety, as you claim. I mean, who doesn't laugh when he reads the same protest in Catullus, that a pious poet himself should be chaste, but there's no need for his verses to be so? Ditto Ovid's, believe me, my character is different from my poetry. People assume speech tracts one's true feelings. I get it, though, you don't care what people think. So, as requested, here you go. Events proved Camerarius right. When he died, Obsopoeus had been putting together a translation of epigrams from the Greek anthology. The book, which includes that moving tribute to his wife, came out posthumously. In it, Obsopoeus tucks away a tiny look back in a comment he makes on an epigram about drinking games. He had discussed that topic extensively in Book 3, although, again like Ovid, it is impossible to tell how seriously his advice was meant. I wrote a lot about that in The Art of Drinking, and I hear a lot of people are trashing me behind my back for publishing it. They say I went too far. Whatever. Obsopoeus doesn't care. Sed haec non sunt curae Obsopoeo et Hippoclidi. They can go on hating and criticizing me until they explode. Such was the darker side of Obsopoeus. But he had a lighter side, too, especially in regard to his fondness for wine. When Melanchthon offered to help him get a job, he replied that the advertised salary was so low, it won't even quench my thirst. Melanchthon didn't find that funny. His lighter side also appears in a letter he wrote Camerarius on December 14, 1536. Like Obsopoeus, Camerarius was from Franconia, but he had moved to Tubingen, a city overlooking the Neckar River. I'm eager to know what those Neckar wines of yours are like. Ours, in Franconia, I mean, are really virile and strong. They're responsible for not a few wounds and murders, this year especially. Till now, I thought I was a champion drinker, capable of handling the most intensely violent wines. When I drink wine this year, though, I turn into a kid again after a couple glasses. The upshot is that despite all my arts of drinking, cum omnibus meus artibus bibendi, I often land in the muck and mud and get stuck there. Saepe in stercore et luto sit jacendum. All his life, and even into death, Camerarius seems to have remained Obsopoeus's one loyal friend. He wrote a funeral sonnet declaring that his friend had made it into heaven. Alas, death and mighty fate have defeated Vincent after overwhelming him with a painful illness. Farewell, Vincent, and be glad you are not in Hades halls, since the road of death no longer leads good men there, but high above the summit of golden Olympus, That is where the abode of Christian heroes lies. Maybe Camerarius was on to something. As fate would have it, the next year's summer was the hottest in history and the best German vintage of all time. It got so freakishly warm in 1540 that the Rhine had dried up, and the resulting wine was so good that a fancy barrel was built in Würzburg to commemorate and hold it all. Maybe that wasn't a coincidence. Heaven accepted Vincent when he departed this world, and it released wine-presaging omens in Franconia. The scorching sun of 1540 cooked the Rhine and grapes and dried them up, and recompensed Würzburg with an exceptional vintage. Then, again, maybe it was. Either way, Vincent would have loved it. Enjoy the poem. About this edition. The art of drinking first appeared in 1536. That printing became the basis of every reprint of a loose German translation in 1537, and of an incompetent English translation in 1945. In 1537, however, Obsopoeus published a second edition. It includes an expanded text, a new preface, and several new liminary poems. I have taken it as the basis of the present edition, which I offer as a third edition of The Art of Drinking. This edition omits a gigantic insertion in Book 1, a long digression in Book 3, Obsopoeus's two prefaces, and most liminary poems. The one liminary poem it does print, by Joachim Camerarius, is from an improved text found in Camerarius, 1568. A note on the translation. Styles of translation vary. My aim here was not a slavish and surely not a verbatim translation of Obsopoeus's text. That would be a hopeless task. Instead, my aim was to transmute Obsopoeus's thought and spirit into clear and idiomatic English as it is spoken in the United States today, especially as I hear it spoken on college campuses. This has necessitated the use of some metaphors that will jar listeners if taken literally. For example, Obsopoeus frequently addresses juvenes, a word I translate as college kids or simply kids. Why? Because in 2020, nothing else will do. Young men or young people is hectoring, guys is off, and youths, the dictionary meaning, is ridiculous. Obsopoeus wrote in the classical Latin of pagan Rome 2,000 years ago to describe life as he lived it in Christian Germany 500 years ago, and like Ovid, he speaks as a professor delivering a lecture. His overarching argument is carefully plotted out. To help listeners follow it, I have introduced subheadings in the English. Furthermore, Obsopoeus frequently assumes presentation mode, constructing a syllogism or piling up example after example to prove his point. When he does, I have reformatted his couplets as bullet points, sometimes at multiple sublevels, to indicate the rhetoric. An example is Book 1, verses 877 to 882. Music cheers grieving hearts with song. Music has divine powers on par with Bromius, that is, Bacchus. Bacchus lifts and cheers the weeping with nectar. Music lifts and cheers the depressed with song. He fills the breast with warmth. She stirs its feelings, and as does wine. So do sounds in harmony penetrate the chest and heart. Another problem is that Obsopoeus is a great player on and with words. Many couplets exploit some double meaning. For example, in Latin, sinus means your lap or bosom, and a sinum, a separate word, is a bowl you drink wine from. Meanwhile, fundere means to pour out liquid, literally, and to pour your thoughts or feelings out metaphorically, to confess them. Obsopoeus combines both into a brilliant pun in Book 1, verses 95 to 96, where he is advising you to drink at home with your wife. You can trust your wife completely, always. You can drink with her and pour your heart out on her bosom without fear. In such cases, usually I had to ignore one meaning, though at other times, as here, I felt I had to translate a word twice. Similarly, Germanus and Germanus are two different words. The first means German, and the second means brother. Since this accident of language underpins the concept of bro culture, my only choice for the UNS drinking song in Book 2, verse 428, Hic, hic, Germani discubueri boni, was to say, Hear, hear, good old German Hermanos are partying here. A final matter calls for comment. Obsopoeus uses many names for a person who drinks too much, and they force a difficult choice on us. How do we decide between drunk and alcoholic, or desire and craving, or addiction and alcoholism? And indeed, what is the difference? The joke has it that alcoholics are simply drunks who go to meetings. True or not, I doubt alcoholism and alcoholic would have made any sense to Obsopoeus, so I usually refer to drunks and desire. Nevertheless, I have made exceptions where the context seems to warrant it. A quick start guide to the art of drinking. Bacchus, the god of wine, has four common cult titles: Bromius, Iacchus, Lenaios, and Laios. Obsopoeus uses them all, and each can be a poetic word for wine. Hence, worshipping Bacchus can also mean to literally drink wine. The most famous wine of antiquity was Falernian.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.